Hi everyone, welcome to week four. And you're probably watching this video thinking, okay, is he going to talk about the midterm or is he going to ramble on for a little while? Well, I am going to briefly introduce the midterm, but yes, there is a separate video that talks about how to do the midterm and all of that specific stuff. And of course, that's on the activities page or at the midterm assignment itself. And maybe you've already checked that out. But yes, I am going to briefly introduce the midterm here. Some concepts that we need to wrap our minds around before we can jump into it. But if you're just, I would hope that you're not just trying to use this week just to focus on the midterm, because there's still a lot more to learn in this short 8-week class in terms of principles that we can learn to design and develop the web. So sit back as I'd like to talk about some key things, specifically working with text and layouts. As you know, I'm your instructor. I've been enjoying teaching you guys these 8 weeks, of course, and I look forward to working with you more this week. This week we are continuing into the design and development of our websites, aside from the midterm, but I definitely hope that the midterm perhaps can be a showcase piece for your portfolio, and I hope it's something that you're really going to enjoy. In terms of designing and developing our sites this week, we are specifically chatting about typography and layout. And when you think of typography and layout, you're probably thinking, okay, is he hungry or something? Well, in my mind, I love using the analogy of a burger, because all of these different aspects of the burger all work together to really make a really good burger. Here in St. Louis, I have some of my favorite burger places. For example, I love Llewellyn's Pub Burger over in Webster Groves, over right by the home campus. And there's many aspects of it that just all work together to really form that perfect burger. So take this analogy and apply it to a website. Typography and layout are just two of key pieces that by themselves don't do a whole lot. But putting them together along with, of course, the content, functionality, and just the overall, you know, visual design of the site, like we've been talking about before, really make the site sing. So we could argue, if we were in a face-to-face class, we would probably argue, you know, what's the most important part of the burger or what's the most important part of the site. But for the purposes today, I just want you to understand that typography and layout are two key aspects of the site that we really do need to consider. Whether you want to think of them as the cheese or the burger or the bacon, perhaps, that's totally up to you. So when we talk about typography, those of you with a print design background are very familiar with typography, but I'm also surprised that many web designers you're getting more interested here these days, and it's really becoming more and more of a prevalent thing, because it kind of can separate one design from another, because our goal really is to make sure that our designs are creative and are set apart. Now, do they need to be drastically apart, where a site doesn't feel like a bank website when you're on a bank website? Because you wouldn't want your bank website to look like a blog. But I do think that to separate perhaps one bank website from another, a typography just could be one piece of that, the burger, that could really separate Llewellyn's Pub Burger from a McDonald's burger. So when we talk about typography, like I said, those of you with a print design background, and notice even here at the bottom, the synonym is printing. You know, typography is the art or process of setting and arranging types and printing from them. We're not necessarily printing from them, but in a sense, we kind of are when you think of a website, because our designs are essentially being printed, or so I usually use the word like parsed, on our browsers, on our different user agents. And then when we think about typography, we're talking about the style and appearance of printed matter. Now, we're talking, from a web design perspective, we're talking about the style and appearance of how the designs are parsed in our different devices. So when we think about print, I mean, we could have, you know, amazingly cool looking typography of something like this. I mean, obviously this image has lots of text and it's all visually designed in very different ways. And we can do this with a website as well. I mean, look at this fun image. I mean, these are all just random letters thrown together. These letters have different colors, different sizes. They're all arranged very differently. And like I said, you know, why should our web designs be something necessarily very simple, very basic, because there's a lot that we can do in terms of visually designing our text through the use of typography, through the use of basically of CSS. But I'd like to give us sit back just for a second, and we're going to watch a quick little think of this video that we're about to watch as like an homage to old educational videos from the 60s, but it's basically just a few minutes. It's going to talk about some of the basics of typography. Now, this video was created for more for those who are interested in the graphic design, but through the use of CSS, we can basically do a lot of these things ourselves. So sit back and let's watch a quick little video.
Typography is what language looks like. It is the art and techniques of type design, modifying type glyphs, and reaching type. Type glyphs are created using a variety of illustration techniques. The arrangement of type is the selection of typefaces, point size, line length, leading, and kerning. The anatomy of a letter form consists of stem, baseline, ascender, descender, counter, serif, x height, and many more characteristics. Typography is most commonly performed by typographers, graphic artists, and art directors. The digital age opened up typography to new generations of visual designers. A good typographer is someone who communicates a point of view with skill and imagination, and makes the type taste good.
One of the articles that I'm having you guys read this week that talks about typography is kind of like a progressive typography article, if there is such a thing, because it's somewhat kind of radical. You know, it says that, you know, 95% of a website is typography. I think as you read it, you'll come up with your own opinions of that. I mean, but when you think about it, largely our sites filled with content are basically text, unless I guess you have a site that is mostly just showing videos. But largely, generally speaking, especially for informational websites, which is, you know, the preponderance of the web, you know, largely they're just text. And that text, that raw content, can be styled many different ways. You know, for example, we could change the size of the text, right? Change the size. We could also change the spacing between the letters, very common, or perhaps change the font. And of course our favorite, which is, you know, change the color. So when you think of CSS, the styles are grouped in basically these two main categories. You're either going to be stylizing the raw text or you're going to be stylizing the font. So when we're stylizing the text, we can be changing things like indent, spacing, height, alignment, outline, shadow, and of course color, and there's also a few others that I didn't even mention here. So definitely be exploring that this week. And then in terms of font, you know, of course the stylize of the font, the weight, the size, etc. And our goal, as always, is to do all of this with a external style sheet, so that we can have all of our rules listed on one style sheet, and that can then be applied site-wide. Because imagine if you were doing all of this styled on every single page, how difficult it would be for a site like Amazon to update their site. And again, that Mustang over on the left-hand side, just think of that as the raw content. Whether you make it red, whether you give it a sunroof, or different types of rims, or different types of lights, leather seats, etc., it's still raw content, and it's all being styled one place. Another thing to think about this week is I'm giving you another article to read that talks about the differences in how we should size our font. So, in the basically, if you as you look at this table, it'll show you here that some fonts are scalable, some fonts are not as scalable. Man, that was a tongue twister, right? So think about that, because we want to make sure that our designs are as responsive as possible for our different user agents. I mean, here 5-6 years ago, we really were truly basically just using pixels. Now, your decision after reading the article is to really determine, are you going to be using EMs, or as some people say, Ms? Are you going to be using Ms, or are you going to use percentages, because those are the most scalable? So make sure, I mean, sometimes this is a little bit of a difficult concept to wrap your mind around, but think of it, see that bottom row, site equals. So 1EM is a scalable font that basically is relative to the overall size of the font on the page. So 1EM, if the main size on the page is 12 points, then 1EM would basically represent 12 points. Now over on the percentage side, over on the right-hand side, 100% is very similar. So 100% would represent, if 12 point was the main size on the page, then 100% would represent the 12-point font. So then you could increase the size to maybe 105%, and that would basically mean that your headings would be that much bigger than the main font on the page. So when you're thinking about this, the main reason to think about it is in terms of scalability with different user devices. So what's the difference? Well, like I said, it all has to do with making sure that our pages are parsed and responsive to the different devices that they're going to be viewed on. When someone's viewing your site on a phone, if they're set to, 12 pixels, that 12 pixels is the same size if it's on the phone or if it's on someone's television screen. So, something to think about in terms of how you should be sizing your fonts. And again, that's all controlled with external CSS, because essentially the content is the same, but we're stylizing all that with an external style sheet. And we can also, let me just transition into talking about layout in CSS. Another piece of that burger, definitely aside from typography, is going to be layout. And I introduced this last week, but I think that maybe this week you guys have got up to speed a little bit more in terms of layout, and I know that when you guys are exploring the midterm, which I'll talk to you about in just a second, I know for you guys that are waiting, the midterm is going to be dealing with that as well. But layout and CSS, again, all controlled with an external style sheet, that's going to give you these different types of layouts. These are just the most common ones. But in terms of the visual design for this course and talking about design principles, just a little history. In the past, 5, 6, man, probably even going on 10 years ago, when I was teaching courses like this, I would always talk to students about making sure that the content would fit, within a certain, at that time, unfortunately, that was in tables, but that was all we had. So we would be designing our content for our page, basically, and I would suggest it shouldn't be no bigger than the width of a dollar bill, because that was basically the size of computer monitors at that time, or laptops. So I was telling students that it needed to be, around 960 at the maximum width of the content. And of course, that was styled at that time in pixels. And then eventually we started centering tables and suggesting that the user having spots on the page to rest their eyes. So then we were doing like 600 and 700 with columns and different things. This is back in, early 2000s, or 1999 when you think of it. But now with different user agents, as you know, there's different resolutions of pages. You might have a high resolution monitor, a high resolution television, but then also the different sizes of the screen sizes are become very important as well. So when we talk about the visual design more so these days, I think a concept that we presented back at that time is perhaps even more important than that, which was the concept of being above the fold. That's where the most important content needs to be, up at the top of the page, because that's what the user is going to see as soon as they navigate the site. And that might be your one time to truly grab their attention. So that's why you want to make sure that the main, most important content is up at the top of the page, or a sense above the fold. And when you talk about above the fold, I have a discussion of it within the course. You know, the concept comes from printmaking. That, think of it as like a newspaper. You know, the headlines of the newspaper were always up on the front. So that's why they above the fold. If you someone walking by a newspaper stand, you know, they're gonna jump and grab that newspaper largely because of what's above the fold or what's on the front page. And the same is very true for websites. Now, we do have web designers and people these days, and of course, the perspectives of this are very diverse, but there's this notion of below the fold as well, and how these days users have learned to scroll, right? Users have learned to scroll, so don't, it's basically this blog that I have suggested for you guys to read, suggests don't feel like you that everything has to be above the fold. And it suggests a very obscure notion of making sure that it's possible to have a lot of things below the fold. So it would even go to say, you know, the user scrolls. So within your design, you could essentially have content below the fold. And for example, here's a quote at the very end of the article. A very fitting word to describe the state of web design today would be samey. So basically what it's saying is that if everybody has across web design here at this day and age, we're in, you know, going on 2014, 2015, you know, at this point in time, if all websites are following all of these visual design principles, they're all essentially very the same. So we have to figure out a way to accentuate our design, one design from another. And that's largely where creativity comes in. So in a sense, what this article is suggesting is, you know, how to, you know, break out of that mold. But then, you know, also you need to be careful about how you break out of that mold. Like I was saying earlier, you know, we do want to think creative about our designs, but we also don't want to make sure that if it's too creative where a bank website doesn't feel like a bank website, then there's a problem. So I hope you guys enjoy that article. It actually is something that came to me recently from another student in another class, so hope you guys enjoy that. So when you think of that in terms of layout, we still have these different sections, and ideally there's certain types of content that go in these different sections. I'm not going to necessarily talk to you about the content that goes in with them are important, and it's important to understand which types of content should go in these different types of sections. But largely in this class, we need to make sure that we understand how to style them and the best way to do that, whether you're using HTML5 or contextual classes with divs. But in terms of the content that goes within them, you think of it in terms of the top, the header area. Generally speaking, that would be where your primary navigation would go. And of course, the middle, you know, the main spot in of the page where the user sees, that would be the main content space. That's where all of the main content would go. And then we have two different sets of navigation. We have secondary navigation on the left and tertiary navigation over on the right. And then, of course, in the footer, we have miscellaneous information. Often that's where you find things like, you know, copyrights, as this suggests, legal issues, etc. So perhaps through the use of this, you know, you could think creatively about what goes in these areas, but then again, the users are still expecting, because the user should always have an effortless experience, right? The user is still going to be expecting, you know, the primary navigation up at the top. If the user scrolls down to the bottom of the page, then you figure out a way to easily get up to the top of the page. A user, you've heard me say this before, a user should always know where they are at every point in the site. They should never be confused of where they are. And then, again, the user always needs to make sure that they know how to get back to the home page. The user should never have to rely on their browser's back button. The web design should be designed in such a way that the user always has an effortless experience, knows how to get to the home page at any time, knows exactly where they need to go and how to get there. They should never have to question anything. And largely, in terms of layout, putting the right types of content in these areas will help them do that. But then again, we should be figuring out a way, as that article suggested, the life below 600, to separate ourselves, to accentuate our design from other designs. So thinking creatively about that. But then again, I perhaps maybe a little bit more conservative than others. You know, we have to be careful to make sure that in our creativity, that our designs aren't totally foreign, where our site, our bank website, doesn't look like a blog or something like that. Or the user should, you know, definitely make sure that they know how to get to where they're going at any point in time. So again, that's of course controlled with external CSS. The content is still the same, but how we design that visually, how we design that functionality, perhaps would be different. The content is always still the same, still the Mustang. So when we're doing those contextual classes and stylizing those different things, essentially this could be, you know, we have our whole entire page in this one large container, and then we have these different divisions. This especially is what you should consider when you guys are doing it in terms of divs and contextual classes. But of course, this is very similar for HTML5 as well. So you would be stylizing perhaps a drop-down menu in this nav division that you have set up on your page, with an unordered list or an ordered list or what have you. And then, of course, you know, you might have a main content area, and you could be stylizing your paragraphs and your headings and things like that. This week, as I start talking about the midterm, we're going to be exploring an old resource that you guys have used, perhaps, I'm assuming, in lots of other classes, which would be CSS and Garden. But what we're doing with it is we're taking not the original design of CSS. Well, we are taking the original content. We're taking the original Mustang from CSS and the Garden, and we're going to be exploring one of the other designs. So I give you the resource where you can go and choose. I mean, there's hundreds of them out there that other people have gone and visually designed and visually created functionality and layout and stuff like that with the original design of CSS and Garden. And what you're going to be doing is using the resources found in your book to update that design. So essentially, you're going to be giving it a cold version of someone's new design or a hot version of someone's new design. So that's one aspect of the midterm. But then what you're also doing is you're going to be setting it up to where the cold design is pulled up with a specific type of browser, and the hot design will be called up from a specific type of browser. So I hope you guys enjoy that. But basically, you're going to be using somebody else's design, taking their photos, taking their style sheet, and taking the photos and giving them a hot perspective or giving them a cold perspective using your image editors, and then integrating those new images into the new design, someone else's new design of CSS and Garden, and essentially it becomes your new design. And then you'll share them with the class, and then depending on which browser that they view the site in, it's going to call the cold version of the site, cold version of the new design of CSS and Garden, or hot version of CSS Zen Garden. So hope you guys enjoy that. But then again, like I was saying, that all boils back to what I've been talking about in terms of layout and CSS. So for the activities this week, we need to make sure that we are reviewing chapters 1-5 and also chapters 8 and 9 of our Painting the Web book. I do have suggested Linda videos for us to watch in terms of typography and layout in terms of CSS. So I'm going to present those here in just a second. And then for our discussions, I just wanted you to share with us, you know, which design did you choose for the midterm and why? Perhaps just tell us why you liked it, because all of those different designs of how someone is taking the content from CSS Zen Garden and visually designing it, they're all very different and they're all really cool. So I hope you guys enjoy looking at them and then talking about the different ones that you've chosen. And of course, the assignment is obviously the midterm, and then the extra credit. I do have an option here, which is about relationships. So I'm hoping that someone's going to go from the class and watch that video and then share an executive summary of it within the class. And even if you're not the person who's doing the extra credit, or maybe you don't even have time this week because of you're bogged down with the midterm, definitely I would suggest, please, you know, bookmark this video and watch it at a later date, because I think it's going to be add another just tool in your repertoire, or give you another perspective of being a web designer and working with a client. So I hope you guys enjoy that. For Linda this week, like I said, we're watching stuff about typography. So that is Web Fonts, First Look by James Williamson, and then I have specifically three chapters from that to watch in terms of typography. In the next one, Typography for the Designer, from Laura Franz. So I have these suggested here to watch. I know that a lot of you are probably going to be more concerned with the midterm, so maybe you're not jumping into learning stuff about typography this week. But what I'm hoping is maybe next week or on down the road, you will want to. So I'm not going to be presenting these again at that time, because I have certain videos that I suggest for you to watch each week, And again, it's still up to your choice whether you watch them or not. The key thing to think about, though, is if you could maybe go into them, give them 5-10 minutes of your time, at least have an awareness of what is there within those resources, and then that way that you can at least go back and refer to them when you're ready to refer to them. Because I personally feel like the best way to learn is when there's a problem that you have to solve. So right now you might not be specifically trying to solve a problem about typography, but I'm hoping along down the road you will have a problem that you're wanting to solve about typography, probably just because you want to learn more about it, do something cool with your text on your site. So perhaps these videos will help you with that. And we checked these out last week, but feel free to jump back and go ahead and rewatch, or perhaps you didn't watch them last week, the CSS page layouts video from James Williamson, who we're very familiar with, as there you will learn more about the different types of layouts, especially if you guys could get into at least, at minimum, reading about the fixed and flexible, which again boils back down to the different types of sizing, EM versus percent, things like that. So I'm hoping, again, maybe this is a problem that you're trying to solve this week in terms of layout, so I hope these videos will help with that, as they'll fulfill the demonstrational aspect of this course, that because I don't want you to just be learning in this course via your book or some online articles. Like, I want to make sure that you actually are having someone demo for you how to do some of these things in terms of HTML and CSS. And as with, I've been trying to mention every week in terms of the course and the term project, but even this week thinking about the midterm, majority of the students in the class are going to get perhaps a B or a C, because that's just on average, because especially for the midterm I have to grade it with very specific criteria. But what I'd like to see is that more than just a few of you will be approaching your midterm and of course your term projects with perhaps more of a creative spin, as I've been mentioning this week in terms of design and how to think creatively with our designs. And as always, as I always like to leave with you at the end of every week, be sure that you are being an observant web user this week. Think about, how are they doing that on their site? How can I do that? Or what could be better on their site if they were to do X, Y, and Z? Especially in terms of thinking of our course in terms of design principles. How can we improve the functionality, and how can we improve the design? And of course, let the class or I know if you have any questions, especially when it comes to the midterm. Be sure that you share those in the general questions area. Have a good week.